Good afternoon and welcome to the Helen Gurley Brown Presidential Summit on Women in Science. I am Brienne Ryan and I work in Dana-Farber's Division of Philanthropy. We are thrilled so many of you could join us today to hear from our incredible panelists. Before we begin, some housekeeping items. To ensure everyone can adequately hear today's program, you are tuning in by webcast with no video or audio. We encourage you to participate in the summit by submitting your questions for the panelists to the email address located on your screen, hgbevents@dfci.harvard.edu. We will do our best to cover as many questions as possible. I am now pleased to introduce Dana-Farber's President and CEO, Dr. Lori Glimcher.
Good afternoon, everybody, and thank you so much for joining us today for the fourth annual Helen Gurley Brown Presidential Summit on Women in Science. This year, of course, we're hosting it virtually for the very first time. As Brienne said, I'm Lori Glimcher. I'm the president and CEO of Dana-Farber, and I want to welcome all of you to this terrific forum for discourse and an exchange of ideas, which will center around yet another stellar panel of women in science. I was pleased to hear that we had over 450 registrants. That's one of the benefits of the virtual world. People have a lower threshold to joining meetings when it can be from their home. And I am really grateful for this outstanding attendance. This is our largest gathering to date in our fourth symposium. I also want to welcome and thank very much the members of the Pussycat Foundation who are joining us today. I am so grateful to you for your unwavering support of Dana-Farber and this vital initiative. I want to begin this afternoon's event by acknowledging how difficult the past few weeks and months have been, particularly for communities of color. We certainly have navigated uncharted waters during the COVID-19 outbreak, and COVID-19 pandemic will pass, but racial injustice won't pass until we become galvanized into action. The murders of George Floyd, Breonna Taylor, and Ahmaud Arbery are three devastating tragedies among far too many similar incidents in our country. The COVID-19 pandemic has also shone light on disparities in care for Black patients, with large numbers of Black patients dying from COVID-19, far more than their percentage in the population. And this is just unacceptable. Now is the time for all of us to commit to being anti-racist, to being better allies for people of color, and to doing more to ensure that patients from diverse backgrounds receive equitable care and treatment. In science and in medicine, it remains crucial for us to remember that to produce the best scientific research and provide the best care, our investigators and our clinicians must be representative of the communities that we serve. And I want to acknowledge that this afternoon's panel is missing the perspective of a Black woman in science. We are committed to ensuring that our conversations include all voices, and we will again next year make a concerted effort to have an even more diverse panel for next year's summit. Please know, we've heard your feedback. We're determined to do better in this regard. Although the format of this year's HGB Presidential Summit is clearly different, our focus remains unchanged. We are here to support each other as women in cancer research and in medicine, and to hear from very prominent and successful female leaders in the scientific community. For those of you who may not know, Helen Gurley Brown was a longtime editor of Cosmopolitan magazine, and she was a huge advocate for women. She strove to ensure that women were empowered in their professions so that they could serve as role models in the workplace. The term, the Pussycat Foundation, is a nod to Helen Gurley Brown's favorite term of endearment for her family and friends and her colleagues. So it's Helen's legacy. And on the slide now coming up is a slide showing the names of Helen mentors and fellows in our first cohort. And do we have that shown now? Yes, there they are. And they are a diverse group and a wonderful group of female postdoctoral fellows who we call the Helen Fellows. who are mentored by senior female investigators, and they're called the Helen mentors. So you see in the slide, both the mentors and the fellows in the first cohort, the first two-year cohort. We were very pleased and grateful to the Helen Gurley Brown Foundation for renewing our first 2 years with another 2 years with twice as many Helen mentors and Helen fellows in the second cohort. And I'm very proud to serve as a Helen mentor to my Helen fellow, Dr. Han Dong. And I think you can see now in the second slide, the second cohort. I've always believed that it is critical for senior women to give not only intellectual, but also emotional and frankly, financial support to women scientists. We need financial support to drive women's careers. And this program is an excellent example of that because it enables the mentorship and promotion of women. And we can ensure, thanks to the generous gift from the HGB Foundation, that they have the resources that they need to continue to advance their careers in the field. And I'd like now to share a short video featuring some of our Helen mentors providing their thoughts on how women can support each other. And I believe that this is a message of female empowerment. And I hope that Helen Gurley Brown's spirit is somewhere in the room looking down to see this. So if you would show the video, please. I had to be asking big questions and taking risks.
It's the confidence. Have the confidence. It's a daily effort.
Don't hesitate to think outside the box, especially as physicians, scientists, mothers. If you can conceive of what you need for success, you can make things happen.
You have to be patient with your own timeline.
At some point, I just had to accept that, you know, you can do everything. You don't need to give an explanation.
For women promotion, we need both genders to help us.
Cancer doesn't wait just because we're in a pandemic. If we're going to realize the promise of research and meet the urgent needs of our cancer patients today, and while the survival of patients with cancer has increased, we have to be aware that the incidence of cancer has also increased. So we need to light every fire and every passion that we can get from our female colleagues, because we can't afford to lose 50% of the brains and talent in science and medicine. And I like to quote the incomparable Marie Curie, who said, "I was taught that the way of progress was neither swift nor easy." And I think here today, we're amongst some of the most talented and determined women in science who know that's true, but whose tireless efforts have contributed to and advance our way forward. And now it's my privilege to introduce our wonderful panel of female leaders. I'm going to start with Dr. Sangeeta Bhatia, who's an MD and a PhD. She's the John and Dorothy Wilson Professor of Engineering at MIT, where she adapts technologies developed in the computer industry for medical innovation. To be specific, she leverages tiny technologies of miniaturization to yield inventions such as human microlivers that model human drug metabolism and liver disease. Sangeeta is a prolific inventor, and she's a passionate advocate for diversity in science and engineering. She's received many honors, including the Lemelson MIT Prize, which is known as the Oscar for inventors, and the Heinz Medal for groundbreaking inventions and advocacy for women in STEM fields. Our next panelist is Dr. Michelle Cleary, who is CEO of the Mark Foundation for Cancer Research, which is a nonprofit that actively partners with scientists to accelerate research that will transform prevention, diagnosis and treatment of cancer, and the Mark Foundation has been extremely generous to many of the cancer centers in the country. Prior to joining the Mark Foundation, Michelle served as VP of Clinical Translation and Technologies and Operations at Bristol-Myers Squibb, where she led biomarker research for cancer and other diseases. And before that, she served in several leadership roles at Merck, overseeing the development and application of innovative platforms for understanding cancer pathways, identification of new therapeutic approaches for multiple diseases, and functional validation of novel drug targets, and identified through human genetics. She's a co-author of more than 50 primary research papers and co-inventor on multiple patents with direct application to cancer drug development. And our third panelist is Dr. Martine Rothblatt, who is the chairman and CEO of United Therapeutics, which is a biotech company that she founded to save the life of her daughter. The company offers FDA-approved medicines for pulmonary hypertension, for neuroblastoma, and is now working on manufacturing an unlimited supply of transplantable organs. Prior to United Therapeutics, Martine created and led Sirius XM as its chairman and CEO, where she launched other satellite systems for navigation and international television broadcasting. She also designed the world's first electric helicopter and piloted it to a Guinness World Record for speed, altitude, and flight duration. In the legal arena, Martine led efforts of the transgender community to establish their own health law standards and of the International Bar Association to protect autonomy rights in genetic information via an international treaty. And aren't we so thrilled that the Supreme Court has actually become a bit more liberal and has recently ruled on two important things. One, an LGBTQ rules and regulations, and also, of course, in DACA. So as we get started, I just want to remind everybody that you can send questions during the panel discussion to the email address that now appears on the bottom of the screen. And with that, let's get started. I want to go back to my earlier comments regarding the racial injustices that have plagued our country for hundreds of years. And I'd like to ask each member of the panel to address the lack of diversity in the sciences. Sangeeta and Martine, let me turn to you first. What can we do to improve diversity in STEM fields? And Michelle, from a funder's perspective, can you please speak to the importance of supporting science led by diverse researchers? So I'm going to turn to you first, Sangeeta.
Sure. Hi, everybody. It's a pleasure to join you today. And Dr. Glimcher, thank you for that question. Of course, it's a very big question. What can we do? I think that we have learned some lessons from history on, at least on women in STEM, that have to do with first understanding why we lack diversity. What is it about our systems that structurally are keeping women and minorities out? Then we have to understand the people in those systems, both conscious discrimination or overt discrimination and unconscious bias. And then we have to think about the pipeline into the system and making sure that that's full. And once we've sort of understood those things, we have to take action. And I think it'll sound boring, but I think maybe to an audience of scientists, it will resonate. The first thing to do is collect data, make policies based on that data, monitor change, and then repeat. My favorite example of local change like this is the gender equity report at MIT, where I'm on the faculty, that was issued in the 90s. That tracked the number of women on the faculty and their rights and privileges at the institution. And they first gathered data, they institutionalized change with the backing of a strong leader, the president at the time. And over the course of about 15 years, they doubled the number of faculty and equalized the playing field at the institution. And that effort spread to many others. So that's just an example, but I think that's essentially a model for change in many different arenas.
Thank you, Sangeeta. Martine, What are your thoughts on this?
Yes, thank you for inviting me on the panel, Lori, and glad to be with everybody today. I think that there's one of the fastest ways that we can effect some change is to provide opportunities for women of color to actually work with us in situ in our work environments through different types of internship programs, starting as early as I think, you know, fourth, fifth, sixth grade, being more intense in junior high, and then full on in high school. We participate in a wonderful program called Urban Alliance, which operates in several cities, where students that are in disadvantaged high schools, overwhelmingly Black high schools in most of these instances, with the students being overwhelmingly Black, that the students are given opportunities to work in different technology companies, STEM-related companies. We have several in our biotechnology company. And us professionals, I think it's the right thing for us to do to allocate a good chunk of our time to mentor and support the young people. There's, you know, if you have motivation and belief, like you said in the introduction, or Helen Gurley Brown said, anything that can be conceived and believed can be achieved. And if we give people an opportunity to actually see a different world than they see, the exciting work that we do in the life sciences departments of universities and companies, and have an opportunity to be given a project that they can actually see the complete arc from conception to completion during a period of several months, that's going to be equal to years of traditional academic education. So I think we need to welcome into our organizations the beautiful young Black women who are in elementary schools, junior highs, and high schools today.
Thank you. And Michelle, from a funder's perspective, do you speak to the importance of supporting science led by a very diverse group of researchers?
Certainly, thank you. And thank you for having me, Lori. It's a pleasure to be able to join this esteemed panel and share the perspective of a foundation that funds cancer research. It is really important that we have diversity in science. The investigators who are pursuing problems need to be broad and rich. And the reason for that is, as a foundation, we go out to look for the unmet needs in cancer. And to uncover true unmet needs, you really do need to have broad perspective. Everyone has different experiences, and they bring those experiences to what they would identify as an unmet need in cancer. They also have different perspectives on what's interesting and novel. And then finally, everybody, based on their background, will approach a problem very differently. And we need all of that blended into the mix to really truly be successful in moving the needle in cancer. Curiosity and problem solving comes in many different flavors. And if we concentrate on one demographic to solve those problems, we're going to stay very narrow. So we go out and we do try to keep our portfolio of research programs to the extent that they are covering many, many different areas in cancer. We're only 3 years in existence as a foundation. And one of the things that we've been able to do in the last few weeks is to do some inward reflection and look at the investigators who have been funded by our funding programs. And we realized that we're not really achieving the diversity that we need to achieve as a foundation. And so we've taken a step back and put together teams on our staff who are taking an unbiased approach to trying to understand what can be done for us as a foundation, and maybe those learnings can translate to other funders of science and cancer research in particular. One thing that's really clear is that when we look at our applicants, and our applicant pool is not as diverse as it should be. And so we want to understand what's keeping diverse researchers away from applying for our grants. I think one thing that's really clear to us is that if we have diversity among our teams, and that includes our staff, our scientific advisory board, and our board of directors, then we may come across to the community as more inviting for applications from people of color and scientists from diverse backgrounds. So that's one of the areas that we're going to pay a lot of attention to. And you know, one thing I do want to say with respect to science as a career is science is a very fulfilling career, but as we all know, it's also very challenging. And one of the challenges to getting to success in bringing your science forward shouldn't be resources. So whatever we can do as a foundation to get through that barrier and then work with other foundations to share best practices and move together in this space is going to be really important for us to no longer be part of the problem, but be part of the solution.
Thank you. Thank you, Michelle. I'd like to segue to another topic that I know continues to be on everyone's minds, and that, of course, is COVID-19. I was looking at a paper that was released in April by the National Bureau of Economic Research, and it was entitled "The Impact of COVID-19 on Gender Equality." The paper explained how what the effect of the unavailability of childcare during the pandemic primarily affected women, particularly early career women faculty, and predicted that this would disproportionately prevent them from completing their research compared to their male colleagues. And other publications have raised similar concerns. And indeed, preliminary studies have found that women researchers are submitting fewer manuscripts than men to academic journals. So I'm curious, Martine, how do you think COVID-19, in your experience, is having an impact on women-led scientific research? And what can the scientific community do to minimize how this pandemic impedes the pace of research progress specifically for women?
Well, thank you for your question, Lori. I'm going to only really be able to speak with regard to our own organization because that's where I have the direct experience. We have about 1,000 scientists and researchers at United Therapeutics. And several areas of our clinical research and science are led by women. We also have on-site daycare, childcare by a wonderful organization, Bright Horizons, at our different locations, and we provide that daycare to everybody. I myself would not have been able to complete my education at UCLA because I was a single parent if it wasn't for the UCLA Child Care Center, and I vowed to myself that if I ever had any responsibility, I was going to make sure that daycare was as important as electricity and plumbing to the operation of an organization. So soon after COVID, we really faced a terrible dilemma. Either we shut down the daycare, or we exposed the overwhelmingly women daycare workers and their families to a heightened risk of COVID health problems. And so we reached a decision to close down the daycare facilities in Maryland, North Carolina, where we have our largest concentrations of people, to continue to pay the salaries of the people who work there. But suddenly the women who are leading clinical development, research and development are now working from home. And in Zoom meetings like this that we have all day long, you know, you do hear kids running and jumping into the field of view of the Zoom camera. So we've all just sort of accepted this and done the best that we can with it. A lot of our research cannot be done from home, so we opened up a 24-hour shift. Most of our places used to be open basically like normal working hours, 8 to 6 or whatever. So now our laboratories are open 24 hours a day. So women and their partners, if that's an option, are able to take turns watching the kids, and people can go in and continue doing research and scientific experiments during the middle of the night when it's perhaps easier to find somebody else to help with the daycare. So in our own experience, it has been an additional burden that women have had to disproportionately shoulder. But the good news is that we've been able to continue our research and development activities, perhaps, 80% as much as we could have before. And as soon as it is safe to bring the daycare facilities back up to full staffing again, we are totally committed to doing that.
Sounds like you're doing a great job too.
Terrific. Thank you, Lori.
Michelle, has COVID-19 impacted grant making at the Mark Foundation and in the larger foundation landscape? Do you have any particular feedback for women who are as they return to the bench? I'm sure everybody in our audience would appreciate any advice from you on that.
Yeah, certainly. We are concerned about the funding landscape moving forward. We're a foundation that relies on the support of a very generous donor who hasn't actually withdrawn that support. But we do have partner organizations that are struggling because they rely on fundraising activities, many of which are face-to-face. Cyclothons, walkathons, and the like do require people getting together to actually execute on those activities. I think I'm seeing some creativeness and virtual innovation to being deployed in this regard, but it's still very uncertain for those foundations and organizations about how their cash flow is going to go over the next year or so. So what we've heard is that foundations in some regards are holding back. They're either suspending having an RFP launch, for example. Some foundations have withdrawn grants that were awarded but not yet executed, and others have pulled back some of their funding. And it's understandable why they need to do that. They need to be very careful about cash flow over the next year. We're not in that situation. So what we've done instead is we've understanding that shutdown labs mean that laboratory progress is not happening. However, we know that our researchers are doing work. They're analyzing data, they're planning the next experiments, they're trying to work through the challenges of having the lab shut down and then reopening all at once. So we've been continuing to support salaries. We have worked with our grantees to decouple progress reports, scientific progress reports, from the actual payments. And then we're working very directly with the grantees on what are they needing in terms of resources and funding right now, because we anticipate that when labs open up, there's going to be a need for resources that weren't planned for when those grants were written and submitted and evaluated. So we want to be a good partner in that regard. The other thing that we've done is since when we started as an organization, we learned the ropes by partnering with other foundations, and we have some really strong relationships with those foundations. So we're brainstorming ways that we can continue to partner and help them with some of the struggles that they're facing right now in terms of the resources that they're projecting that they're going to need for the next year or so. There'll be some partnerships that you'll see announced between the Mark Foundation and other organizations. We have actually executed two RFPs during this pandemic situation, one of which is in partnership with AACR, and we're very excited about that. And we're going to continue to do whatever we can to make sure that cancer doesn't get neglected during this period.
Well, that's terrific. I know that there are Dana-Farber researchers whose grants have been slowed or terminated simply because of a lack of a cash flow. So that's wonderful to hear. And these are all wonderful nonprofit organizations that have been so supportive of cancer research and have really made a difference. Mentors are critical. I think probably the most important thing we do as senior women doctors and scientists is to mentor younger women. Although I think mentorship is important through every stage of a researcher's career, but particularly during challenging times. So we received a pre-submitted question from the audience that begins with the following. As a young woman in research, I have found it difficult to find female mentors. While I work well with the male mentors I have, I feel the absence of a woman mentor in my career. So Sangeeta, I'd like to pose the following question to you. What advice do you have for women on finding and building relationships with female mentors, especially if you don't find yourself naturally coming into contact with many women in your specific field?
Sure. Yeah, that's a great question. I think, you know, I came up in the system as first as an engineer, or I was a physician scientist, and I didn't have a woman professor until the fourth year of graduate school. So there were no women to be mentors. And so one thing that I did for myself was sort of take apart the role model piece from the mentor piece. And what I recognized was that the men in my life who were invested in my success, you know, starting with my dad and my graduate advisor and so on, they were actually terrific mentors. And then I could look out across the landscape and identify women that I felt were role models, and many of them strangers. Some of them I would be lucky enough to later get to know, like Susan Linguist, who was an amazing woman scientist.
She was.
But it was a long time before I had anybody who was both a role model and a mentor. And so I guess my advice would be to collect the pieces that you can from a variety of people, you know, recognizing that no one person may provide all that you need.
Yes, well, back in the day when I was a young assistant professor, there were very, very few women in senior leadership positions, and it was very difficult. In fact, I did not have a female mentor for many, many years. So, Martine, I have to ask you this question because there's been such exciting momentum in space travel recently. What are your thoughts on the SpaceX rocket launch and the role that women in science have played throughout history and going forward? You certainly have been an important part of that.
Thank you very much for the question, Lori. It's the most exciting time that we've had in space since I think probably the 1960s and 70s, and I don't think I'm being exaggerating there. This is a time when we're able to see with our own eyes rockets landing back straight up with their, you know, landing pads on a floating barge. And if you were to say something like this to people just a few years ago, they would say, oh yeah, like maybe in 30 years or 40 years, that's science fiction. But that's something that's being done routinely now. And it's a woman who's in charge of that. I mean, while Elon Musk gets a lot of limelight, and deservedly so, the person who's actually doing, I would say, 90% of the work, because she's the president and the chief operating officer, is Ms. Shotwell. And she's doing an extraordinary job of running an organization that spans from Florida to Texas to California and accomplishing these extraordinary feats that SpaceX is doing. And she and Elon have been working together for over 15 years. So this is something that she really built up, you know, from the ground up. I think it's also very exciting that we have a NASA administrator today that in every public speech that he gives relating to going to the moon, he always says, you know, we're going to send, you know, the next man and the first woman to the moon. And this is, I would say, sending a woman on the next lunar landing. It's in the DNA of NASA. At this point in time, I do not believe it can be erased. And it's not like a thing of gender. There are tons of highly qualified women pilots and women engineers and women technologists. So it's not like we weren't ready to go to the moon from the 60s. It's just we were fighting, like, you know, impenetrable discrimination, you know, for all of these decades. But we're a long way from the promised land, but I think we also have to be realistic that, you know, the glass is not almost empty. I mean, the glass is at least half full and is filling up. And so I think that there has never been a more exciting time for women in aerospace than right now, 2020.
Great. Michelle, you've got a lot of experience going across different disciplines and industries across the sciences. So I'd love to hear from you, given your roles at both Bristol-Myers and at Merck prior to joining the Mark Foundation, what's your advice for scientists who are looking to transition from academia to industry or industry back to academia or to a nonprofit? What advice would you give to, in particular, women who want to make that transition?
Yeah, thank you for that question, Lori. You know, when I made the transition, I had actually no intention of going from academia to industry, and life took me in that direction, and I'm really happy that that's the way things turned out. You can have a very fulfilling scientific career in the biopharma space sector and learn a lot and continue to grow as a scientist. So while there's this initial trepidation about moving into industry for someone who has really enjoyed all of the benefits and luxuries of being in academia and exploring science in a very free way, you still get to explore science in industry and you actually get to learn some things that could be very valuable as a scientist to shaping your thinking about how science should get done. In industry, there tends to be quite a bit of focus on moving things quickly, because the longer we wait, the more patients wait to get the benefits of what we're working on. So being able to think critically about what are the experiments that are going to get us there fastest while still maintaining rigor does actually create a mindset of being very diligent and deliberate about the work that you do. Learning that process of what it takes to take a scientific discovery all the way through to something that is going to benefit a patient it's not trivial. There's quite a bit of nuance and intricacy in developing that path. So scientists that go into industry will learn what it takes to do drug discovery. They'll learn what it takes to translate an idea from something that has rigorous validation in an academic setting to something that has rigorous validation in a human patient. I've learned so much being in industry, and I don't feel that I've ever really left academia because of the interfaces that both sectors have. Most of what I did that I enjoyed the most in my roles was collaborating with academicians who had something that could benefit what we were doing in our industry objectives, and we had something that could benefit them. So most of those collaborations were what we call in-kind, where Merck in particular, we had vast capabilities that could be deployed for our academic partners. And in return, we got to move the science forward together. The other direction that's very interesting to watch how this is shaping up, it was, I would say, probably within the last few years, has it become common for scientists in industry to move back into academia, just because the reward systems aren't really set up for scientists who aren't leading the traditional academic lab. But many of my former colleagues from both Merck and Bristol-Myers Squibb are now leading drug discovery efforts embedded in academia, and this is a perfect partnership to really make it work. So it's been just delightful to watch how those efforts are playing out and how those efforts are moving new targets forward and new therapeutic assets that we probably wouldn't have envisioned if the two realms stayed separate.
I like to say, and I firmly believe, that the partnership between academia, biotech, and pharma is a marriage made in heaven for our patients. Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
Sangeeta, You had an article, there was an article in Stat earlier this year that talked about your exciting work with Dr. Susan Hockfield, who was the former president of MIT. And she actually, coincidentally, she spoke at the HGB Presidential Summit a couple of years ago, which explained your efforts to address a very important question: why don't women biologists establish biotech companies at the same rate as men? Would love if you could share a summary of your research and your preliminary findings.
Sure, yeah, thank you. You know, this project with Susan and also with Nancy Hopkins started a couple years ago. I was on sabbatical doing a startup of my own. And I noticed over the course of that year that there were very few women in the boardroom when I was pitching venture capitalists, very few women founders to ask for advice. And if you look in the data, you can see actually 2.7% of VC dollars go to women-founded companies. And 1% to Black founders. So my experience was very representative of this space. So what we got together and decided to do was look at the data at MIT. I mentioned before that we believe in data. And so we asked across 8 departments at MIT, in the School of Science and the School of Engineering, how often were women and men starting companies? And it was about under 10% of the startups coming out of those departments over about 30 years were founded by women. And if we adjusted per capita, if women had started companies at the same rate as men across the board, we counted that there would have been 45 more companies just out of MIT in biotech. Wow. In that time. So when you think about that from a, you know, patient perspective, all of those inventions were being lost. When we looked at some departments, I won't name the department, but one department in particular, there were 56 companies started, 2 by women, and 26 companies across 3 departments where men had co-founded with one another, and none of them had a woman co-founder. And so you start to get a sense that you know, women are being left out at this interface of academia and biotech, and there may be many reasons. They may not have experience, they may not be on the boards, they may not have access to capital. And so these are the sort of the next phase of our work, which we're calling the Future Founders Initiative, is to try and address those things.
Great. So in closing, you all have such incredibly impressive backgrounds, and I'm very appreciative, and I think we all appreciate you as current leaders in science and taking the time to join us this afternoon. But I'd like to ask each of you, if I can, to share the most pivotal leadership lesson you've learned, perhaps from a mentor or something you now teach your mentees. Martine, why don't you start us off?
I think the most pivotal lesson that I've learned came from a female mentor whom I was blessed to have. Dr. Robin Barst, she was head of pediatric cardiology at Columbia Presbyterian Hospital. Unfortunately, she passed before her time from cancer. But Dr. Barst said to me that never to be limited by what I thought I could not do. She said, if you try something and fail, then you've been limited by objective factors in the environment. But if you don't even try something, then you're just limited by little neural connections inside your brain. And how stupid is that, to allow neural connections, electrons that have barely any mass at all, to block you from changing the world?
That's great. Michelle, what about you?
So I learned from one of my mentors that I don't have to always keep it buttoned up. I don't always have to project an air of confidence and having it all together. In fact, it's more important to show authenticity. And people want to know what you're passionate about. They want to see that passion, both positive and negative. They want to see when you're not enthusiastic about something, and they want to see it in a very real way. And that's what gets people behind you. Not having all the answers, but getting people that you can recruit to help you solve the problems in a very collaborative way. And the only way to do that is to show your real self.
Sangeeta?
Well, those are both great lessons. So as to not repeat, I'll say the one that that I think is really important is to think about the profession that you're entering. And when I was coming up in science, I actually was not sure I wanted to be a physician scientist, not because I didn't love the science and because I wasn't passionate about what we could do for patients, but because I wasn't sure I liked the competitiveness of the profession and the culture of the profession. And one thing that someone said to me very early on was, if you enter into the profession, you can change it. You can change the profession. When you become a leader, you will build the organization in your vision, in your sense of what the right culture is. And so don't let that, your image of what the profession is, keep you out of it. In fact, you should enter into it and we can all change it. And so that's something that I've lived by.
Great. So now we have time for a few questions from the audience. We had several questions that were pre-submitted, so we'll start with those. And if you have more, just use the email address at the bottom of the screen to submit any additional questions at this time. So here's, I'm gonna put two questions together. In your career, have there been situations where you've questioned your ability to succeed? How did you overcome this, and how do you persevere through discouraging experiences as women in medicine and or science? Who would like to go first for that one? Sangeeta?
Sure, I can go first. So I've already showed you all that I'm a nerd and I love data. And I would say the one thing that I always do when I'm worried about my ability to succeed is to prepare and to over-prepare and to be excellent. So that's my sort of like go-to coping mechanism. And then the other is I have tried to develop a thick skin because I have learned over time that I will get underestimated and I will, you know, over-prepare and just sort of knock it out of the park. That's kind of been my general strategy.
It's a good one. Didn't have to do it. Michelle or Martine?
Yeah, I can take this next. Actually had this conversation today with somebody. We were talking about bullies and, you know, our careers are riddled with bullies. And there have been times where I felt, why bother? Why am I hitting my head up against the wall to still have to face all of this? And the one thing that I've learned throughout my career is that you shouldn't let the bullies be influence a decision to leave what you love doing, because 100% of the time, if I just maintained a little bit of patience, those bullies would be pulled out of the way. And, you know, if they're bullying me, they're bullying others, and there are smart people who are picking up on this, and sooner or later, they will move out of the way. So it shouldn't influence what you do in your career.
Martine, any comments you'd like to make?
Well, I kind of joined the geek club with Sangeeta. I'm a fellow card-carrying member of that club. And the thing that I'm probably geekiest about are Gantt charts. So when I find something that seems impossible for me, or people say it can't be done, where I go to is breaking it down into smaller and smaller pieces, until I get down to a piece that's small enough that I can do it. Now, sometimes that piece might be small enough, like I have to find a book on this subject because I know how to read. So I'll read the book on the subject. The book will have references to other types of information. I'll read the references, then I'll be online. Then I'll find out that there are conferences and symposia and workshop for this particular topic. So whenever there's something that seems impossible to do, I just go to breaking it down. And I think my adage is that there's nothing that's impossible. It's just a question of rearranging all of the little Gantt blocks to find the critical path to get there.
Great, great answers. How, here's another question from the audience. How do you motivate and inspire millennials?
So I could start by since it was last time, I'll take the first shot at it this time. Our company, United Therapeutics, is about 40% millennials. So that is pretty much our culture, and it's growing all the time. We find that millennials really, like anybody, they like to have autonomy. I think people are happiest when they have control over a project that they have a passion for. So what we try to do is we follow a basic kind of management rule in our organization, which is that autonomy must track responsibility. If you give somebody responsibility for something, you have to give them the authority, the autonomy, the power to do that. They might fail. That's okay. I mean, the only way that evolution succeeds is through failure, you know, and goes for cultural evolution as well. So another important thing that we do, Lori, is we try to live humanistic values. I mean, like one example is that we save lives. That's our job in our company. We're a therapeutics company, but we also have decided to make all of our buildings zero carbon buildings. And the way we just kind of break it down, and the way, like, I think a lot of millennials see it, is what's the sense of saving individual people's lives if the whole world is going to die? And that's a logic that a lot of millennials go straight to. Actually makes perfect sense to me. So, you know, following like President Obama's old adage that like a president has to be able to do a couple things at the same time, I think an institution, a university, an organization has to be able to do a good thing for patients and a good thing for the planet at the same time. And I do believe that that ethic is central to the millennial culture.
I'm gonna go actually to the next question because we're almost out of time. And I think it's an important question. What or who prompted you to pursue the work you do now? And what's been the most exciting and rewarding aspect of your career? Who would like to start off?
So I guess I'll start. I had a very charismatic physics teacher in high school who talked all about the lunar landing module and how he worked on that for Grumman. So I started my career as a physics student and then got attracted into biology later on, and just always loved the problem solving that's built into science, identifying the problem and then using your brain mathematically and otherwise to come up with a solution and then trying that out in the lab. I think what I do now, even though it's a little bit at arm's length to that, it's so much fun to sit down with scientists who are grappling with a cancer-related challenge, and they have the pieces of something that sounds like it's really good, but just a little bit more of the brainstorming and input from others who have different perspectives, like myself, based on what I have seen in my career, and then shaping something into a project that that's going to be impactful, and watching as that plays out and the results are generated in the laboratory is it's very inspiring to me.
Sangeeta?
Yeah, I'm really inspired by this generation of trainees. I think, Martine, as you said, they have really a humanistic perspective. I run a center for nanomedicine, at MIT. And one of the technologies is a nanotechnology that we think can be used for early cancer detection, potentially in the developing world in a resource poor setting. And these trainees are so kind of fearless and excited about that direction. And they're not worried about whether early detection is a good career area or whether there's a reimbursement model, or, you know, they just really are inspired about the potential to make an impact. And I think for me, what that means is having a very inventive point of view around people who have the vision and the energy to take it forward, closely linked to the clinic. That is a conversation that we kind of need to amplify and need more of.
Believe it or not, it was actually a 10-year-old girl, Kristen Gilday, who was a friend of my daughter and a patient friend of my daughter. She also had pulmonary arterial hypertension. Even though it's a rare disease, the two of them lived just a few miles from each other and became friends. Kristen had a very rapid progression of her pulmonary hypertension, ended up with a lung transplant. She rejected it, and she spent the last year of her life in a hospital waiting for a retransplant. She was a lovely girl, played beautiful piano, and I sat there watching this experience with my daughter, thinking, how crazy is this? That we can replace the parts of buildings to last for hundreds of years, aircraft to last for decades, and we can't replace the part of a basically a mechanistic thing. You know, as Michelle was saying, you know, biology, it's biophysics. It is ultimately mechanistic, if a bit black boxy. So I decided that I was going to create an unlimited supply of transplantable organs so that, you know, the next Kristen Gilday would not have to die this way. And then the most rewarding moment for me came a couple of years ago when we began refurbishing thrown away organs. Eight out of 10 donated lungs that are people have suffered brain death, and they were organ donors and they wanted to donate their lungs. 8 out of 10 of them are thrown away because of the condition of the lungs. So we've begun taking those unwanted, discarded lungs and refurbishing them until half the time they are transplantable. And then I met this woman, Heather Leverington. She was a college sports coach. She also developed pulmonary hypertension, needed a lung transplant. There was not one that was going to come available in time for her. She agreed to take one of our refurbished lungs, in fact, a pair of our refurbished lungs. She recovered rapidly. She went on to win a gold medal in the Paralympics for shot put. And I was able to hug her and just feel like, you know, the vibrancy of her life, to know that we could, like, you know, here's a person, we could bring them back to life through manufacturing organs. So that was the answers to the two questions you asked me, Lori.
Well, on that note, that wonderful, wonderful note, we've come to the end of our program. And I want to thank the audience for your participation and your thoughtful questions. And thank you again to our panelists. It's really been such an honor to hear from the three of you. You each have different perspectives, and I am incredibly grateful for what I've learned from the three of you. And I have even more confidence that our mission is backed by an extraordinary community and supportive visionaries such as our panelists. We can't do this work alone, and I very much appreciate your partnership as we move forward from this particularly challenging time in history. And I'm looking forward to moderating next year's summit, and I'm hopeful that we can all see each other in person then. So we're signing off. Many, many thanks again to all, and have a good evening. Stay safe and stay well.
Thank you, Lori.
Thank you, Lori.
Thank you, Lori. Thanks for your leadership. We'll be right back.
Thank you.